Hello again. In this video, we're going to be looking at Sky-Watcher's AZ5 deluxe altazimuth mount and tripod and the AZ5 telescope range. Before we get into the detail of the AZ5 range, let's just take a quick look at the overall family. The amalgamation we've got here is once again old and new. We've got some very tried and tested optical tubes, firm favourites from the Sky-Watcher range. I think we might almost call them classics. They've been around quite a while now and have got a good steady following. You'll be easily able to find lots of good reviews and favourable things that owners have said about all of these instruments. What's new in the AZ5 is, of course, the foundation of the AZ5 system, and that's the mounting. That's this deluxe Altaz mounting system. It features a dovetail cradle connection, so we can fit anything with a 45mm Vixen dovetail bar directly to the AZ5 mount. Generous bearing surfaces here. You can see just by eye, I can judge that these are about 70 to 80 millimeters in diameter, making for a nice smooth system. Very large gear and worm sets in here, making the thing feel very precise and smooth as I try to operate it. Decent sized locks on here as well. The tripod all this is sitting on is something we've seen before, but only recently. You may recall in our presentation of the AZ Pronto, we showed you this tripod. So again, this is a fairly early outing for this tripod. You may remember the extension column for the AZ Pronto. It's exactly the same with the AZ5. Each model in the series is supplied with one of these. Pretty much whether the telescope needs it or not, you can see we've got it fitted here to the refractor AZ5. It also comes with extension flexible knobs. As it comes out of the box, we've got these rather short, stubby, I think very convenient and very ergonomic knobs. I find them very comfortable when using telescopes of this kind of length. But if you wished, or if you used it with a larger telescope, you can actually fit these flexible handles. They simply come off with a screw. Anyway, onto the telescope tubes that are actually fitted as part of the range. There's only one exclusive astronomy telescope, and that's the Explorer 130p. We've got a good 650mm focal length here, a useful aperture of 130mm. This would make a good starter scope for somebody setting out in the hobby of astronomy. Nice easy mounting, obviously, to operate it with. It's going to feel a lot like using a Dobsonian. It's got that same kind of feel to it. Simply plonk the mount down and start looking through the telescope. Comes with two eyepieces and includes a red dot finder. The Startravel refractor is suitable for terrestrial and astronomical observations. Comes with an erect image diagonal 30mm finder, a nice aperture of 102mm, focal length of 500mm. Terrestrially, it'll give you the same kind of optical play that you would get, I think, from a good quality spotting scope. But with all the advantages of being able to change the eyepieces, attach cameras, and use a variety of other accessories with the instrument, comes with a 30mm finder. Big gun in the middle here is the tried and tested SkyMax Maksutov, 127mm aperture, and a whacking 1.5 meters, that's 1500 millimeters of focal length. Don't be confused by the tube sizes. This really is the big daddy in the AZ5 range. The instrument is optically folded, so all of that focal length is kind of compacted into this tube. If we straighten it out, we've got that full 1.5 meters of focal length. Now, it's supplied in the configuration to make it suitable for terrestrial viewing, but you'd need to bear in mind this is terrestrial viewing at the max. This is really going to be suitable for very high powered viewing, maybe of nesting birds that are well out of reach, maybe of shipping on the horizon, that kind of thing. For the normal kind of mid-range telescopic viewing of things that you see in your garden, nearby wildlife, probably a little bit too powerful for that one. That's where the Startravel would really come in that mid-range area. So let's start by showing you the mount in a bit more detail. Let's start by taking this tube off. We'll show you how easy that is with the dovetail bar. You can see, just undo the top screw and that comes straight off. Let's put him down there, somewhere safe. This is quite different to any of the other mountings we've seen from Sky-Watcher. We've got full slow motion worm and gear sets on here. They are supplied with very nice, short, stubby, rather ergonomical handles straight out of the box. I really like the feel of these when used with any of the instruments that are supplied on the AZ5. These can be replaced, of course, with these longer flexible handles that are included with all of the mountings, and when you buy the mount with just the tripod, you can buy it as a mount tripod set. And also when you buy the head on its own, you also get these handles with it as well. So it's a fairly comprehensive option in terms of the operating handles. The drive system is these worm gear sets that are really quite generously sized, and they are fully user accessible. You can control them in terms of the amount of tension quite easily with a grub screw fitting just here, and you can also get at them and get access to them for servicing to repack them with grease or things like that. I mention that simply because these kind of things that get a lot of use, if they have a long service life, which I think this product was intended to have, it's nice if you can actually get at it and make improvements as it gets a little bit worn or something like that over the years. And I think this looks like a product that's got a very long service life. It's very solidly made, all cast construction throughout. The engineering has been done to, I think, a very good standard. It looks good as well. You can see this very smart, organic look to the altitude index. It looks like parts of a tree that has grown out to grab hold of this part. And I think that's a nice element of the AZ5, that it's not just functional, but it looks nice as well. So it's going to make a handsome looking telescope stood at a window in a smart modern home. It was one of the things I think that was lacking in some of the earlier versions of this type of product. The tripod that it's all sitting on, we've seen before, of course. You'll recognize it, I think, from the AZ Pronto. It's quite good enough for the telescopes that are supplied in the AZ5 range. And I think a good move by Sky-Watcher is the fact that they've made this product available as a head only. So you can actually buy it from just here up, just the head on its own, or you can buy it with the head and the tripod. But that gives the user group, I think, a lot of flexibility in how this gets used. The mounting point on the base, let me just show you that, is 3/8 prosumer. So this will fit onto any solid professional tripod. Do bear in mind, it needs to be quite a substantial tripod, like the one that is supplied with it. But if you wanted to improve on this, it's going to have to be quite a substantial tripod indeed. But you can see it's a very simple 3/8 setting. All of the models, both the ones with the telescope tubes in the AZ5 range, plus when you buy the head with the tripod, you get the extension tube that we're looking at here. Let me just show you that in action in case you missed it on the AZ Pronto. So that just fits at the bottom, and then we undo the screws around the top here, hopefully without dropping them on the floor, and the whole head just comes off. This gets attached to the bottom of the AZ5 head. And then we drop that back into the extension tube. That's one of the handles gone on the floor. Gravity, doesn't it get you down? Okay, there it is. And now it's ready for a much longer telescope tube, perhaps a long refractor or something like that. So adding very significantly to the height of the tripod. Obviously, to a certain degree, it does add a little bit of extra shake, possibly, but I think they've kept it to the absolute minimum. And again, it works well with all of the telescopes supplied in the system. The locks on the azimuth base, I'm just going to rotate this around so that I can show it to you. The locks here and the one underneath here enable me to gradually increase the stiction and the amount of resistance offered by the slipping clutch. And I rather like that because there's nothing worse on an altazimuth mount if the lock goes from nothing to fully on in half a turn. This one allows you quite a bit of scope to gradually increase the resistance as you lock the thing up, which makes it feel good when you're putting a telescope on here and you're going to move it around. It's good if there is some kind of feedback coming from the head, and it does feel very smooth. It's not at all lumpy, so they've obviously got a good way of managing that thrust from the lock here. Got to be honest, I would like to have seen the knobs on this perhaps a little bit long, a little bit larger, maybe 30 mil or something like that, but I think they had their reasons. You can see it wouldn't easily clear the underside of the casting here, so they obviously had to keep this in size, but they're good enough to do the job, and they're good enough to provide your fingers with a bit of feedback. Main use of this telescope mount, I think, for a lot of us will be as a grab and go mounting, something that we can just put out very quickly and put a telescope on it. The dovetail mounting bar system certainly takes care of that. The standard 45mm Vixen style dovetail. One little thing to bear in mind, of course, we can't vary the angle that the dovetail bar is actually positioned at. So this does require that your telescope will have a dovetail bar situated at 90 degrees to the optical axis on the side of the telescope tube rather than underneath it. Does it make a difference? Well, it might do depending on where the finder is on your instrument. Obviously, rotating the eyepiece holder is usually quite straightforward, but if you're using it with a reflecting telescope, you'll need to bear in mind that the tube will, if it's got a built-in dovetail bar, it will need to be situated directly onto the side of the tube so that the eyepiece can be in a usable position. Now, I just want to put the head back on here and just talk to you just a little bit more about the AZ5 head. Supplied with the standard tripod, the head is described as having a payload capacity of 5 kilos, and I don't think there's any problem at all with the telescopes that are supplied with it in the AZ5 range. The maximum capacity of any of them is 3.6 kilos, and that would be for the 127, but my concern would be as the payload weight goes up, and I think looking at just the head, 5 kilos I think is of course a very comfortable weight for it to carry. I think you could easily exceed that by at least 20% without encountering major disadvantages. Certainly the mount's not gonna break for the sake of exceeding the payload weight by about 20%. I think it will easily carry 6 kilos. But I think the point is that when we look at the tripod that's supplied with the AZ5 at the moment, I'm not quite so sure that that would be able to sustain payloads at the 4.5 to 6 kilo range. With the telescopes that they are supplying in the AZ5 range, I think the tripod is fine, better than fine. I think it's actually good and does a fine job with the head. But I think if you're thinking about using it to closer to its maximum capacity and even exceeding that capacity a little, it would do well to actually purchase the head on its own. And full marks to Sky-Watcher for making the head available as a product that we can buy, just the head and the additional handles, the flexible handles, and put our own selected tripod with it. Because frankly, to get that maximum capacity, I think it would need a slightly heavier tripod. Now, just one other little detail to tell you about, and it's one I quite like in terms of the engineering of the mount. It's actually possible to remove the altitude axis completely by undoing these two screws, and you can probably guess that by the additional screw holes we've got here, we can actually orientate it to a new attitude. So it's actually possible to remove this and actually advance the attitude slightly so that this point is closer to the midline of the mounting. Now, that would be quite useful if you were holding heavier equipment on here and wanted to make the overall mount a little bit more stable. So I think that's quite an interesting little innovation. It's nicely done as well, by the way. There's actually a little boss on the inside here that engages with so there's a pin that engages with a hole in the center of the mounting point here, and then the screws fit in these two. One interesting little point though is you can only use these two holes here and their diametric partners on the opposite side. The holes down the bottom here appear to be there just to make a pretty pattern. You can't actually use these holes at all. There is no diametric partner for these holes, so they actually can't be used to change the position of the altitude axis. Just these two screws here. So there's just one small adjustment that you can make from the standard position. Let's look at the first of the AZ5 telescope tubes. This is the Explorer 130P. This is a 130 millimeter diameter parabolic mirror Newtonian reflecting telescope. It has a 650 millimeter focal length mirror. It's an instrument we've seen many times from Sky-Watcher with many different mountings, and it's got a long track record of satisfied users behind it. We see it here with an inch and a quarter rack and pinion focuser and an electronic red dot finder for finding targets in the night sky. Cannot be used terrestrially, is intended solely for astronomical viewing, but will provide an excellent starting telescope view for planets, lunar views, sun with a solar filter, full aperture solar filter, which is not included with it, of course, and for targets in the deep sky. It's a good size for general astronomical viewing. It's an F5 reflecting telescope, so this is going to give you quite pleasing views of faint fuzzies in the deep sky, as well as good planetary views as well. And I particularly like this configuration with the AZ5 mount. Anyone who's used to using a telescope at all will understand what I'm talking about here. It's overbuilt. The telescope tube is a fraction of the payload capacity of this mounting, and it feels good. It feels very, very solid when you're using it. Got a nice feel. The handles present themselves at very comfortable positions when you're at the eyepiece. For me, standing high, I've got the tripod at the maximum position. I don't think you would need to use the extension with this telescope. It's supplied with it in case you do, but I think it presents itself, the eyepiece is just presents itself in a beautifully comfortable range of positions. You can see as I turn it round here, watch where the eyepiece goes from vertical to horizontal. It really is very good. The one occasion you could probably see there where you might want to use the extension tube is as it gets close to the vertical position, there is a risk of it touching the leg here. But you've only got to move it a fraction away from that and it will clear the vertical position. So depending on what you're looking at, if you're going to be spending most of your time on the celestial equator looking due south, you're probably not going to require the extension pillar here, but if you do need it, it is available. Obviously, you can let the tripod down and at the same time put the pillar on and still keep the eyepiece at this very comfortable ride height. The telescope is supplied with two standard eyepieces. It comes with a 25mm and a 10mm. The telescope tube is capable of magnifications up to 250 to 260 times under ideal seeing conditions. Obviously, it'll be at its best at significantly less than that, at around between 150 and 200 times. But the eyepieces supplied will actually provide magnifications of 26 times and 65 times. I'm bound to say, if I was going to upgrade this telescope, I think one of the things that I would consider would be putting the 10mm eyepiece to one side and possibly replacing it by a 12mm plossel. And I'd also quite strongly recommend you get a good quality Barlow lens for the telescope. And I'd probably recommend a model that gives you 1.5 times magnification and 2 times. This would be a Barlow with a removable head that you can actually screw to the front of the eyepiece as well to get a reasonable number of magnifications with the minimum outlay. That would be a good way of upgrading this telescope to make sure you get the best out of it right from the get-go. Next up is the Startravel 102. This is a short focal length wide field refracting telescope, 102 millimeter diameter, achromatic refractor. This is a nice choice for this mounting. Again, giving the instrument a lovely kind of overbuilt feel, well within the mounting's carrying capacity. So the telescope feels, the instrument as a whole, including the mount, feels very overbuilt. With the 102 Startravel on here, equipped with a 30mm finder scope. The Startravel has a 2-inch focusing barrel, so in principle I can fit 2-inch accessories into here. You'd need a 2-inch diagonal, of course, to fit 2-inch eyepieces. What's included is an 1.25-inch adapter with a T-thread suitable for a digital SLR camera. That will work well with the instrument. And it's supplied with an erect image, 90 degree diagonal, for terrestrial viewing. I'm bound to say, with all of the optical surfaces that the Amici Prism offers, and the density of the glass, for astronomical observation, I think you'd be better off replacing this with a simple mirror star diagonal. You're guaranteed, I think, to get better, brighter views with a mirror system having only one optical surface to concern the creator. The net result as well of using the reflected surface is that by avoiding the prisms, we actually get a brighter view as well, bearing in mind every time you pass light through a piece of glass, some of the light is scattered sideways, so it doesn't actually reach our eye. So changing that out for a mirror diagonal would be a good idea. Bear in mind, when you have a mirror diagonal, it doesn't prevent you doing terrestrial observations at all. You'll still see, when you look into the diagonal making terrestrial observations, you will still see a world that looks more or less as you're used to seeing it. Everything's going to be the right way up, but it is going to be flipped left to right. So when you look at a ship, it's all going to be in Cyrillic. It's all going to look like it's written in Russian. But everything else looks more or less the same. So a mirror star diagonal still works pretty well for terrestrial work anyway. Other accessories I'd recommend for this instrument, so that you get the best out of it right from the get-go. The two eyepieces that are supplied, the standard 10mm and 25mm modified achromats, these will deliver magnifications of 20 and 50 times as they stand. The telescope is capable of magnifications up to just over 200 times, quite comfortably, but obviously you would have to buy additional accessories. What I would recommend is that you put the 10mm eyepiece that's supplied to one side and maybe invest in a good 12mm plossel eyepiece. They're not too expensive, in fact, so it's a good idea. If you shop around, you can get one at a very good price, and it will considerably improve the quality and performance of the telescope. And it'll work very well with a Barlow lens, which would be my second recommendation. I'd probably suggest again that you go with the same type of Barlow I recommended for the Explorer, which is a Barlow that can deliver 1.5 and 2 times, so basically a 2-gear Barlow with that removable head that can be screwed directly to the filter mount. That's going to give you, with your with the additional eyepiece, that's going to give you a nice kind of 6 different magnifications that you can use with the telescope and get you started on making some good astronomical observations. And finally, we come to what is probably the top model in the AZ5 range, the SkyMax 127. This really is a mighty midget of a telescope. Don't be fooled by the diminutive size of the tube, which is actually smaller than the Startravel 102. Do remember that this Maksutov Cassegrain design has an optical folding system such that the light path through the telescope basically goes backwards and forwards down the tube and then out the back here. If we straighten that out, we've got a whacking 1.5 meters of focal length packed into this really quite small tube. The instrument has an 11.8 focal ratio. When you reflect on that, and its aperture of 127 millimeters. This is an instrument that is at its best looking at small detailed targets. It is an excellent astronomy telescope. In the way that we see it supplied on the AZ5, they are presenting it to us as a terrestrial and astronomical use telescope, and as such it's supplied with a 90 degree prismatic erect image diagonal. This turns the normally inverted image of the telescope into correctly orientated, so that everything is the right way up and the right way orientated left and right. But it does do that at the expense of the quality and brightness of the image. Bear in mind that the prism system that is responsible for erecting the image that you actually see has a number of optical surfaces that have to be to a very high standard. It is also a fairly chunky brick of glass for the light to pass through, and bear in mind every time we pass light through a piece of glass, some of the light is going to go sideways through the glass and is not going to come to our eye. So the net result is that the prism does make the image a little dimmer. This is not a problem terrestrially, and we get a lot of benefits from the erect image diagonal when we use the telescope terrestrially, but when we use the telescope in what is ultimately its forte, which is observations of the night sky, it might be an idea to replace the 90-degree prismatic diagonal with a simple mirror-based star diagonal. The mirror diagonal only has one surface. The net result is that there's only one conditional to be brought to a high standard, so straight away it's easier to manufacture, and the reflective surface of the mirror ensures that we get the brightest possible image. Instead of losing light as the light passes through the glass, it's actually reflected. Net result is a lot more light comes to our eye. We see a better, more detailed view. I'd recommend that as an upgrade for the instrument. If you're going to do a lot of astronomy with the telescope, and I certainly hope you would be doing a lot of astronomy with it, because that's what it's best at, frankly. When I look at this telescope as a terrestrial configuration, I'm bound to say it's a pretty strong taste as a terrestrial telescope. With the two eyepieces supplied, we end up with magnifications of 60 and 150 times. So the 10mm eyepiece delivers 150 times magnification, and the 25mm eyepiece delivers 60 times. Now bear in mind, so that's its lowest power with the eyepieces supplied is 60 times. That's the highest power you often find on a commercially available spotting scope designed for making terrestrial observations. Most of them top out at about 60, 65 times. It's a relatively rare one that goes as high as 90. So to have two of its standard magnifications with the basic eyepieces supplied, 60 and 150, that's a very high gear magnification ratio. And I can't think of many ordinary mid-range observation cases where you would want that kind of power. That's almost in the range of the kind of powers that you would need to make engineering studies of defects on bridges and the kind of thing that I've supplied this type of telescope for, to look at turbine blades on wind turbines and that kind of thing. So that's pretty much a speciality magnification range for a terrestrial telescope. It's far more normal to go with a magnification range that takes us from the kind of powers that binoculars have, 10, up to 10 times. We normally start at about 15 times with a terrestrial telescope, maybe 20 times, and then rise up to about 60 times. Starting at 60 and then going on from there, that's high magnification. So I'm bound to say, I do find this telescope a bit of a strong taste as a terrestrial instrument, and it might be well worthwhile thinking about your choice there of this as a terrestrial telescope. That said, the instrument really is at its absolute forte when it's looking at the night sky. This is an astronomical telescope, and it will give you absolutely beautiful views of planets, details on the moon, details on the solar disk when used with a full aperture solar filter. That's not included, of course, but it's quite easy to get a solar filter to fit this instrument. The quality of the mounting, I think, is ideally suited to the needs of a long focal length telescope like this. The drives are beautifully smooth, even though we've got all that focal length, which induces so much apparent movement of the image at the eyepiece. Bear in mind, when we've got all that focal length, we've only got to sort of touch the telescope to send everything into a frenzied shake in the eyepiece. This is actually a very solid mount, and it deals with that long focal length really very well. And the overall instrument, I think, is a great delight to use. Now, bearing in mind what I said about the included eyepieces, we get a 10mm and a 25. My recommendations for upgrading this telescope, I've already mentioned the diagonal, which I think is a must if you're going to do a lot of astronomy with it. And eyepiece-wise, once again, it might be an idea to put the 10mm out of the frame and maybe invest in a 12-12.5mm Plossel as the lowest power, the highest power to be used with the instrument. The 25mm can stay. It's not an ideal eyepiece for this instrument. It hasn't quite got the quality of the optical tube, but it doesn't really notice that much because of its long focal length, so it does actually work quite well. Rather than a Barlow lens, you could go with a Barlow lens. Certainly the 1.5 times aspect, the lens head, you could consider that for some Sunday best, very high power views with the telescope. But what I'd probably prefer to recommend is that you fill in the magnification range that's already on offer with the 12mm upgraded eyepiece that I'm talking about and the 25, and maybe opt for something like a 15mm or a 17mm. That would offer you a good option in between. That, coupled with the lens head of the Barlow, would give you a good range of magnifications with this telescope. Well, a lot of good stuff to take in there across the models of the AZ5 range. I think there's just time for a quick recap. First up, we showed you the AZ5 mount, of course, with its full height aluminium tripod. The telescope tubes, we kicked off with the Startravel 102. A good all-rounder here for grab-and-go astronomy and good terrestrial viewing, providing the kind of magnifications that I think you would get from a good quality spotting scope, and a great one for use on the night sky. Lovely to give you deep wide field views of targets in the night sky. A very easy telescope to use, very comfortable, and capable of sustaining quite a few upgrades to make it into a much more powerful instrument as you go along. The exclusive astronomy telescope that we looked at was the 130p Explorer, with its parabolic mirror, featuring that collimated, essentially for life, cell that it's mounted in, making it an ideal choice for the first-time user. A good size aperture of 130mm, enabling you to do some really quite serious astronomy and really get into the hobby with this beautifully easy to use mounting. The AZ5 complements the 130, I think, really rather well, makes it very easy to use and set up, supplied with a red dot finder, of course, as well. And then the jewel in the crown, the SkyMax 127. This is a long established instrument with an excellent pedigree, and I think coupling it with the solid performance of the AZ5, I think this really is a terrific partnership, and is going to add further luster to the 127's reputation. Supplied in the AZ5 system kit as a terrestrial viewing scope with that 90 degree diagonal, the same one you find on the 102 here. Do bear in mind what I was saying about it, because of the enormous focal length that we've got here, the 1.5 meters, that is a bit high gear. It tends to drive magnification very easily and brings in very high magnifications almost with any eyepiece that you use with it. Even what would be a low power eyepiece on other instruments ends up becoming a high power eyepiece when it's used on the 127. And for that reason, I was tending to say that this is not so good for looking at squirrels at the bottom of your garden and diners on your bird table, because you're just not going to see enough of the animal in a wide enough field of view to make that a good and entertaining view. If you want to look at cracks on the superstructure of a bridge, or maybe details of a wind turbine for the purposes of reporting, then I think it's a very fine instrument for that, delivering some of the highest magnifications that you could reasonably expect a terrestrial telescope to do, and therefore a very specialized type of long range terrestrial viewing. It's when it's pointed to the night sky, of course, that it really comes into its own. This is a terrific instrument for looking at planets, very high resolution viewing. The quality of the views really are outstanding. Almost any small bright target is good meat and drink to the SkyMax 127. Lunar views as well, very fine detail in craters are accessible with this telescope, and of course solar details as well with a additional full aperture solar filter. Anyway, I think a great combination here with the 127 on the AZ5. If you want to see more guides like this and tips on astronomy and lots of other things, don't forget to subscribe. And that's about it for this video. We look forward to seeing you soon. Bye for now.